me. Welcome to Vlog 27. Hello, people. How have you been this week? I've been really, really busy. I had a few days filming a big Hollywood movie that I'm not allowed to talk about. So, that's all. And then my car broke down. I literally thought my gearbox had fallen out, but apparently it's just a clutch, which apparently is still a bad thing, especially when you're on the motorway and it happens. That was great. Anyway, getting a new car next week. Bonza. Apart from that, they gave me a couple of days off, so I managed to catch up on all my theatre at the weekend. And boy, wow, what a show I've got for you this week. So on Thursday, it was a press night for Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat at the London Palladium. They've ruined it! Seriously, you had one job. Anybody who knows me knows I adore this show. And as my mum once said, I'm not upset, I'm just disappointed. To be fair, it is what it is. It is the London Palladium. Joseph at the London Palladium. If you're expecting something a bit edgy, updated, current, go and see Jesus Christ Superstar at the Barbican. But if you want some wholesome family entertainment, which feels a bit like a panto crossed with a carry-on film, go and see Joseph. Now, I'm not going to pick it to pieces because anybody on Twitter has already done that. But I will say though, and whoever gave it 5 stars was just deluded. Okay, let's break it down. As you know, Joseph was written nearly 50 years ago, and it was designed by Andrew Lloyd Webber and Tim Rice as a production that school kids could do. And with that in mind, what Lawrence Connor has done has been inspired by seeing his own children in a recent production, by bringing back that essence of making this a production which involves child actors. No surprise really, considering he directed School of Rock. My only problem is, it might be cute to watch your own kids on a stage, but watching little children with beards on play Potiphar, the baker and the butler was just a little bit cringe. As was Sheridan Smith, who they got to play as well as narrator Jacob and Potiphar's wife. It just took all the sentiment out of it. And if we're going to talk about acting, over the top? I mean, I've been described many times as over the top, so I know what I'm talking about. It was just too much. Putting sheep on skateboards is not a way to update a show. And with regards to Jack Yarrow, his voice is exceptional, and he nails Close Every Door, deservingly receiving a standing ovation from the entire audience. However, his acting is a little bit ropey. Whether that's down to the way it's been directed or his lack of experience, I don't know. Or whether it's just in keeping with this lavishly over-the-top production, perhaps. Sheridan is an incredible, formidable actress in her own right. She won 2 Oliviers. But here, she's just awkwardly in your face, over the top, bit too much. I just didn't get it. Sorry. And as for Jason Donovan, I love Jason. Jason Donovan's probably the reason I'm gay. I literally was obsessed with him as a child. I was literally obsessed with him when I used to watch him in Neighbours. And as Joseph, I would have loved to have seen him. But as Pharaoh, oh, just awkward, isn't it? In his defence, he has openly talked about having vocal surgery last year. And if anybody saw that awkward video of him singing with Kylie at Hyde Park, where she snatched the microphone off him to protect him, she recognised as we all recognised watching this show, that his voice just isn't there anymore. And although Pharaoh isn't a big sing, he only gets a couple of songs that he can't pull it off. And it's a shame because as a casting, it's genius to bring him back to the Palladium for this part. When it comes to impersonating Elvis, though, with an Aussie accent, he just reminded me a bit of Frankenfurter from Rocky Horror, which he has played before. To be fair, though, his dancing is incredible. He's still got those moves. Just a shame his voice wasn't up to scratch. As a whole, like I say, for me, I was a little disappointed. For anybody going to see it who's never seen it before, you might well enjoy it. For anybody who loves a panto, and for anybody who loves variety, you'll definitely enjoy it. Sheldon Smith playing the spoons. That's variety. It was just all over exaggerated gestures. And the choreography felt a bit like I was watching an 80s fitness video. That's all I'm gonna say. But in all seriousness, I was really looking forward to this show and I did come away feeling disappointed. In the original show, there's a really poignant moment at the end when Jacob comes to Egypt. It's there in one of the songs. Now, in this version, they've had to take that out because it just wouldn't work when you've got Sheridan playing Jacob. Which is a shame because that's one of the poignant moments of the show. And there's these awkward bits where Sheridan switches between the narrator and Jacob by putting on a fake beard. And then every now and again pulls down a beard going, it's me. It's still me. Yeah. We just wish it wasn't. Sorry, that's a bit harsh, isn't it? Like I say, I just think it's lost a little bit of its sheen. For me. The party was nice afterwards. I managed to bump into Noel Sullivan, congratulating him on Rock of Ages, until he corrected me and said it's School of Rock that he's going into. I can't wait though, he's going to be great. And I like that show. I don't mind those kids. Beverly Knight and Claire Sweeney were there. Loving it. Oh, and Amanda Holden. Wonder whether she'd give it a red buzzer. Here is a little section from the Mega Mix and the end of the show.
Thank you very much. Oh, no. Oh, no. Dirty. Dirty. Oh,
on the coach to Cirencester to see 39 Steps. I've never actually seen this show, even when it was in the West End, and it is quite a little gem of a show. It's an unassuming, comic little farce, and I enjoyed it. Like I say, I've got nothing to compare it to, nor have I ever seen the original film by Alfred Hitchcock. But having seen this production, I am intrigued to go back and have a look and see what it's all about. But the Barn Theatre are brilliant. It's definitely one to watch out for. And if you can't make it down there, go over to Windsor, where this production of 39 Steps is going to be transferring. It was funny. It was very well acted by a cast of four, led by Max Hutchinson, who I recently saw in Hound of Bastables at the Germain Theatre. He is very funny and quite cute with his little moustache. I found it really funny. It's a very cute little farce with some brilliant set pieces and is quite bonkers. In some breaking news, Brenda Edwards has been cast as Dolores in a brand new reworked and rewritten version of Sister Act, which will come to the Curve Theatre before touring. Again, it's being produced by Whoopi Goldberg herself. I do wonder if, like last time, she might step into the production herself. We shall see. Also, it was a delight to see on Twitter the announcement that Jessica Daly and Lucas Rush will be going to China to be in Evita. I love this pair. They are so funny. That tour will be a riot for anybody who's on it. Saturday finally saw the closing of Les Mis, the original and longest running production in the West End. And it goes without saying that the show and the Revolve will be missed. But we are looking forward to the all-star concert version, followed by the brand new reopened Queen's Theatre later this year. On Saturday, I was invited to Goldsmiths College by Alejandro Rojas, who is studying an MA in producing there. She kindly let me in to the rehearsals to see what was going on as she prepares and creates a brand new musical as part of her course. Working with composer Lyndon Samuel, whose recent work included Cleopatra. Here is a little bit from the full video, which you can find on my YouTube channel.
2 pages of script, and there was no music, there was no music ideas, there was no lyrics, it was just a bit of script, and I just composed music to go with the script, and that was it. That's all I sent her. It was about 7 minutes long for 2 pages of script.
Yeah, this is the...
Okay, so it goes...
Yes. Should go for music lifts.
Ideas come straight away. I think when I read the script, I imagined what would I want the music to sound like if I was watching it as an audience member? What would I, as a theatre goer, want to listen to while this script is happening? So I just wrote what I would want to listen to.
Saturday, I went to see Eliza Von Poppers Presents, A Practically Perfect Guide to Living. Now, this is a one-woman show written and conceived by Rosie Williamson, who runs the blog What Would Julie Do? And the successful cabaret series of the same name. Now, in her blog and her series, she pays tribute to Julie Andrews, who she personally idolises. And in this one-woman show, she again pays tribute to Julie Andrews. The show is set up as a kind of workshop, with Rosie playing Eliza as a kind of life coach guru, taking inspiration and guidance from Julie Andrews. It's a really heartfelt show. Now, Rosie herself has talked openly through her blog about her struggles with the industry and with mental health. And this show beautifully addresses some of those issues. And what I liked about it is Rosie's really found a niche that suits her. This show is her style and shows you her as a performer. And there are some quite poignant moments. Now, this show was part of the Mount View Catalyst Festival, having already been taken to Brighton Fringe. And I definitely hope that Rosie and her team do more with it. Straight after that, I rushed up to the Canal Cafe Theatre to see Happily Ever Puffter with Rich Watkins. Now, I've known Rich for about 5 years since he first trained at the MTA. And he is an incredible performer, an incredible, incredible man. Again, like Rosie, he has found a niche. This is a one-man show created by Rich, which really showcases him as a performer. Rich is an incredible performer whose work recently has involved pantos at the RVT and shows at the King's Head Theatre. And he was also involved in a web series called The Grass is Grinder. Now, in this show, Happily Ever Puffter, he plays a Disney prince who's struggling with his sexuality. And it is brilliantly written. It has so many political statements and explores so many themes without forcing them down your throat. In a very jovial manner, which I think is the best way to handle these topics. This show really explores gay narrative, which is something I talked about last week in my blog. There is a certain perception, especially by Disney, to present this archetypal man and woman. There is an ongoing trend to portray gay people in a certain way, and certainly the likes of Disney skirt around gay characters and very rarely incorporate them into any of their work. Whether this will eventually change, I'm sure it will, but how these characters will develop and how gay characters will be portrayed in mainstream entertainment is a big question and remains to be seen. He presents it by interacting with the audience and performing a collection of reworked Disney songs with new lyrics. The lyrics are very intelligent and very observant. And Rich's performance is brilliant. Even down to his costumes, designed by himself, Rich looks like a Disney prince. And he throws himself into this production. I was honestly really, really impressed and really proud of him, because he has done this all by himself. Having spent 6 months creating the show, he brought in friend Don Helm Spur, who's helped to direct and will go on to help produce the show when it goes up to Edinburgh later this year. As well as watching the show on Saturday afternoon, I managed to speak to Rich the next morning. Here is a little bit from that video.
The Above the Stag audiences were so attentive and kind and really listening. But again, we did two nights there and they were entirely different. So the Monday was very listening. The Tuesday was almost as rowdy as the RVT, honestly, actually. They really got involved. It wasn't a one-man show on that night. It was an 86-person show. And then at the Brewers, it was the night before Pride. Right. So we did July the 5th, the night before London's. The fact that we sold out at the Brewers, and the fact that everyone came the night before the biggest night in the gay calendar,
yeah,
was a real honour. And also the night before London celebrated 50 years since Stonewall. So it was an emotion. I was very emotional that night, to be honest, to be able to do something that was for the community and to be there with the community and in a space that I've worked at so often. The Brewers is like home to me, like the RVT. I am Mr. Brewers, the one and only Mr. Brewers. They held a male beauty pageant in 2017, never to be repeated. So I was crowned the first annual Mr. Brewers.
First and only.
Imagine. First and only.
You still got the crown.
I had a sash, but I still got the sash.
On Saturday evening, I stayed at the Canal Cafe Theatre to watch the 40th anniversary production of News Review. If you've never seen this show, it is genius. They essentially take four actors, two guys, two girls, and perform a collection of current and topical sketches which reflect current news. The show is basically a collection of dance and music where they rework lyrics to popular songs to songs that you'll know. It is often very political and very funny. Now, having seen this production several times, I can honestly say that this is the slickest cast they have ever had. The show goes up to Edinburgh for a full run, so definitely do not miss it. On Sunday, I went to see an amateur production of Rent. It was part of the Shaw Theatre's very first queer season, and it is a fitting tribute. Now, this was presented by a brand new production and called Last Minute Musicals, where they give the entire cast 1 week to come up with the show. I don't really understand that concept, to be honest, because I don't think it does anybody any justice. Now, it was an amateur production. However, it was a mix of professional performers, amateur performers, and some new grads. Now, I'm not going to judge too harshly because, like I say, it was labelled as an amateur production and they did only have 1 week to put it all together. And with that in mind, they did a fantastic job. The only problem is, I'm a massive fan of this show and I've seen it so many times, as well as the original version with Idina Menzel and Anthony Rapp. Now, if you're a massive Rent head like me, you know every word and every move and how it's supposed to look. And to their credit, Last Minute Musicals did a damn fine job of replicating that original production. But then it is a revival, so I don't really understand why. But it just seems like a lot of work for one show. I mean, like I say, they only had a week, which meant they couldn't do everything that they would hope to do, especially when some of the cast were only available on certain days of the rehearsals. The whole evening was for charity, and all the proceeds went to the Terence Higgins Trust. Although it is for charity, like I say, as an audience, you're not seeing these people at their best because they've had to rush and throw it all together, which is a little bit of a shame. Having said that, Chris Cadhill, who played Mark, was incredible. He recently appeared in Elegies at the Union Theatre. As well as him, Ralph Bogard, who's an old friend of mine, was playing Collins in a role that he was made for, and he absolutely smashed that performance. So for me, it was great to see these two guys play these roles. Also, interestingly enough, Daniel Iguezan-Lopez, who I recently saw at the Associated Studios in Sister Act. Now, when I saw him in Sister Act playing Eddie, I did think, ooh, he was a bit too camp. Not that I'm one to talk. But here, he played Angel, and it is definitely a better casting for him. He was brilliant. All the cast did an incredible job. But like I say, as a concept, putting an entire production together in a week, I don't know why they didn't just do a concert version and raise the exact same amount of money, and that way they could have devoted more time and attention in just their performances. It just seemed a bit too ambitious. But full credit to them.